to Psychedelics Today. Today on the show, we have Colin Thompson, filmmaker. Most recent film, Light Years, which is great. Should be on some streaming services soon, so stay tuned. Cruel film about kids finding mushrooms and an interesting kind of love story. And it's a really, really great film. I watched it with my girlfriend a few months back, and we really enjoyed it. And yeah, there's just a lot to say about it. So I don't want to go too into it before the podcast. So kind of save that for Colin, and we'll go from there. So, you know, it's based in Burlington, and yeah, a lot of great stuff there. So Burlington, Vermont, that is, for those not in the know. Burlington, I think there's only one real psychedelic Burlington, but I don't know if that's actually true. Kyle went to school there. The band Fish is from there. A lot of other influential things came through Burlington. And weirdly enough, Burlington, Vermont actually looks a lot like Boulder, Colorado, that downtown section. I think the same architect designed both downtown sections. So a little bit of trivia there for you. Anyway, I think that's it. Film, again, Light Years, lightyearsmovie.com. And yeah, they got some press on Forbes. You can check out the IMDb page and a few other things. So fun chatting with Colin. And yeah, I hope you all watch this movie. It's available for rent now. You can stream it all over the place. And yeah, so check it out. And I hope you enjoy this one. So yeah, I guess because this isn't a normal Solidarity Friday episode, you're not going to get any new news from us. It's been a little bit of a slow news week. There's some interesting new microdosing research out suggesting placebo effect as opposed to other effect. But again, you know, probably sample size is a little small. Anyway, the business front keeps chugging along. Businesses are just cranking out there. Canadian Stock Exchange is going nuts. I don't really know how to relate to it yet. I'm hoping to get a grip on the business end eventually. It's just a really weird phenomenon seeing everything kind of accelerate so much, especially because we're in a pandemic, so it all feels a little abstract and disconnected because we're not able to really see anything in the flesh, like at a conference or whatever. So yeah, and you know, we had an interesting thread of discussion around the gentleman who injected psilocybin containing mushroom tea into his body. Really interesting discussion thread on our Facebook group, Psychedelics Today group. And yeah, it still seems a little up in the air about if mushrooms could actually grow in the body. Like, I kind of don't think so. You know, it'd have to be a pretty ferocious infection. You have to be pretty dirty. Your immune system would have to be pretty bad. All of which are possible, I guess. But, you know, realistically, we'd have to run some tests on humans to confirm if that's true. I don't know. I'm sure somebody could do it in an underground lab somewhere and let us know. I'm happy to donate blood if that's helpful. But I don't know if that's necessary. Anyway, I think that's enough for news. We should be back again next Friday with a standard Solidarity Friday episode. And we can't wait to see you there. If you want to support us, check out psychedeliceducationcenter.com. We've got seats selling quickly for our March Navigating Psychedelics course. So if you want to get in on that Thursday edition, we get two different time slots. Check it out. Again, psychedeliceducationcenter.com. I think that's it for now. So enjoy this episode with Colin Thompson, the filmmaker of Light Years. See you on the other side. Hello, everybody. Welcome back to Psychedelics Today. Today on the show, we have Colin Thompson, maker of a new film, Light Years. How are you doing today, Colin?
Good, Joe. Thanks for having me. It's nice to talk
Absolutely.
To you.
Yeah, yeah. It's been a while since I watched your film and we got the chance to record. So happy to sit down with you. It's interesting how I've kind of digested it over time. So, we'll get into that.
How did it sit, Joe? Like a big belly of mushrooms?
Good.
Just churned
yeah,
in there?
Kind of, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. I was feeling what the characters are feeling at times. That's for
Good.
Sure.
Good.
Yeah. So, yeah, let's get into you before we start talking about the film. Like, how did you kind of come into this topic of psychedelics being interesting or something worth pursuing with an art project like this?
They were always interesting to me, but as far as putting it on the screen, it was mostly in it was a reaction to how I'd seen, you know, psychedelics portrayed on the screen, you know, yeah, prior with the, you know, with the half bakeds of the world, with the, you know, I'm trying to think of any, like, even with like, you know, Fear and Loathing.
Right.
Just a kind of, you know, your buddy's head turns into a hippopotamus's head and somebody's licking the bark of a tree, and a pretty unrealistic and unflattering portrayal or of the experience, the psychedelic experience. Mm. And I wanted to also take and make a love story between two dudes that was fused through a psychedelic experience. Two teenage dudes in that platonic cosmic way that I hadn't seen. Like, yeah, you know, it was like where it came from. I wanted to make a super bad but on mushrooms in an accurate portrayal of that kind of love story between two dudes where you're not just running around trying to, you know, get laid, where there's other things on your mind.
Yeah.
So that's where it came from. I think I answered your question. A lot of these things, these questions that you ask me, I probably won't answer, and I'll start talking about something completely different. And you just steer me back in as a shaman would.
Yeah, I know how those folks in Vermont are, so I got this.
Wait, so just for your listeners, because they probably need some refreshers, you're out in Breckenridge, and then what got you started on this whole thing was, because we have a Northeast connection, yeah, right? You're from New Hampshire, but you got started in Vermont, and what was that?
Yeah, so my breathwork teachers, who spent a lot of time with Stan Grof, the pioneering LSD psychotherapy researcher, they run a group called Dream Shadow in Paulette. And sounds, it's a little bit outside Manchester. Yeah. And it's, been one of the biggest things in my life for sure. Most influential things in my life.
Yeah.
And then Kyle and I met because of the Gibsons at Dream Shadow. And so like I was studying this stuff over in New Hampshire when I was at Plymouth State. And then I would like go back over to Vermont and then learn from them in person about these non-ordinary psychedelic things.
Right.
Yeah. So that's kind of the origins. And did you grow up or you do high school in Vermont?
Yeah. Grew up in Vermont, born in Vermont, and then in high school in Vermont, and ended up graduating from the University of Vermont. Mm. And Joe, for your listeners, just inform me, how old are you?
39,
I'm turning the tables on you, Joe. 39.
All right. I think.
Yeah, no, I have to think too. I think I turned 38 in a couple of weeks. Sadly, madly.
Yeah.
But okay, so I just wanted your your listeners to.
Do you have a background in film from UVM?
I had a background in drinking and dreading lacrosse practice and doing enough schoolwork or charming enough teachers to have a, you know, in the range of a B average. It just so happened that I was a English major with a film minor, but I had transferred, and again, playing lacrosse, it occupies every miserable avenue of your mind. You wake up and you just dread going to practice. So everything, and then then you're on a mediocre team in a sub mediocre division. And, you know, you would think playing a sport would keep you from drinking too much, but it kind of does the opposite when you're losing as much as we lost. So while I did have a film minor, it wasn't until a couple years out of school that I was like, that I realized that I wanted to get into it.
Mm. Cool.
Just another case of a bungled college opportunity when kids just go to college too young. The whole system's all out of whack. But we don't need to get into that show.
That's all about
now. I would appreciate an education, but I, you know, it's late.
Yeah, right.
Yeah. So we'll eat psychedelics. Anyway, go ahead, John.
Right. So this is a great example of what mushrooms are like when you're hanging out. So, all right, you wanted to do like super bad on mushrooms, but but clearly it was a lot more heartfelt, and there was, you know,
thanks,
not as many Seth Rogen or whatever Jonah level jokes.
Are you allowed to, swear on this psychedelics today?
Yeah, you do whatever you want to do.
Thank
you
know. Fucking God, Joe. So yeah, I wanted to do less dicks than super bad.
Which is interesting, right? Like this Northeastern attitude, you know, versus like an LA maybe attitude. Yeah. And like your distinct lack of anything urban in the film is really a cool contrast too, because there's no Las Vegas going on. There's no big city really, right?
Yeah.
And I think that's a really cool thing to notice, because there's a good portion of the US population doesn't live in these cities, and they have a different response.
Yeah, they are. They understand the hiking Mount Philo on a belly full of fungus and worrying about having to go home to your parents.
Mm.
Yeah, so that's kind of where it came from, and then that's how when I set out to write it, that's the seeds of it. Make a super bad on mushrooms, but with less dicks.
Now, was this your first film, or did you do a few before this?
You haven't just gone through my canon, Joe? You haven't done a deep Thompson dive? it would be our third feature film. I like to say our, because making a movie takes a lot of sacrifice from all sorts of people and all of my and good friends that helped me get here, and especially my producing partner, Miles David Jewell. You're welcome, Miles, for mentioning you. No, but nothing happens without him and all the, you know, and my friend Scott Nolan and Caden, everybody that came together to make these things happen and are also very into psychedelics on their own accord. But no idea what the question was. I just started thanking people because of my Catholic guilt. I started being like, I don't want to.
That'll happen. Ungrateful. Yeah. So you got three full lengths. You had two full length guys before and then two shorts.
A smattering of shorts, some that I probably had to make unavailable because I didn't pay for a Who song or something. So this is our third feature, but all shot in Vermont, all for the low price of next to nothing. And here we are.
So I get a lot of emails from people who made a documentary or a book or something, and they want me to help them out. And I'll be really honest, the thing that made me want to reach out to you was that you had this film created with Channing Tatum's film production company. Yeah. And I was like, wait, what? He's doing a psychedelic movie? Like, okay. Like,
yeah.
Curious. That's
funny. Yeah.
Yeah.
That's clickbait, I think is what they call it. I've never used the term, but I think that's what it is. Right. We got you.
Yeah.
Their company, their production company, one of it was like Channing's assistant or something, little knucklehead, Garrett something. I don't know. Doesn't matter. He read it and liked it. And, then they kind of signed on to produce it.
Cool.
Yeah. Channing and
New York.
They are in Los Angeles. Channing and his writing partner, Reed Carolyn, are, and I think you touched upon this in that Storming the Capitol episode that you and your buddy were talking about it. And they are the kind of guys that, and I will just want to disclaim right now, I'm not talking shit. They're the kind of guys that, you know how we were saying when it becomes mainstream, you kind of like have these reservations. It becomes, it's like some kid at school listening to your favorite band and you're like, dude, does that make the band less cool? If those guys are on the ayahuasca train, like the Burning Man type people. Mm-hmm. Do all those nerds make Mike's relationship with mushrooms, does it lessen that? Does it lessen how much I love my favorite band? But I think, because you guys were kind of asking a similar question.
Oh, around cultural dilution.
Yeah.
When everybody comes on board.
Everybody.
Like, what happens when everybody shows up?
Totally. And like in the Instagram, the you know, 24-year-old girl out in Joshua Tree. It doesn't have to be a girl. She could be with her boyfriend, whatever. Taking the selfies with the mushrooms and the thing, and it becomes kind of square, but then you flip it over and realize that nobody hears that band like you do, and nobody experiences, you know, your own damn brain like you do.
Mm.
But anyway, that was a long-winded version of calling those guys squares. Back to work.
Okay. So how did you, like, did you do the traditional thing where you just shopped around your script or screenplay to a bunch of folks?
Yeah, no, it was, those guys read it, and I've graduated since then, I should hope, was just so happy. And for years, anytime anybody would like the things that I wrote, I would be so flattered that I would just jump at the opportunity instead of like sitting on it and being like, and expressing an iota of self-worth, you know, I would be like, oh my God, they like it. And so they were the first ones to like it. They were like, let's go find some money. And because I'm a guy that has made a couple movies for next to nothing, one for nothing and the other for a little bit more, they were like, great, let's get this guy to do another thing for nothing. Mm-hmm. So I did. But like, so that's traditionally how you do it. You would, if a script is quote unquote hot enough, it's got enough heat, yes, you could shop it around and you get, it's a chicken or the egg thing. It's like, do you attach talent right to go find the money, or do you, mm-hmm, is the script that good where you can just get some initial funding, go find, you know, get the talent. But we, because it's a high school, it was originally a high school movie. And you know of this, I was not supposed to be in this fucking movie, Joe.
Oh, you were not.
Wait, you don't know that?
I didn't know you were not supposed to be in it.
I wasn't supposed to be in the movie.
Dude. That's amazing. You played quite the substantial role for not having to be in it.
Yeah. No, it was, because I was in our other movies, and this one, I was finally going to be officially behind the camera. And then Judy Greer and Nat Faxon were to play the parents, and we had all the kids cast up. And then 2 weeks before we started shooting, Judy Greer dropped out. And and then everybody, then just the wind got sucked out of the independent gusto sails, and and everything was kind of screwed. We were, again, 2 weeks out from shooting, and we were coming up to
just Kitty from Arrested Development, Judy Greer?
Yes, exactly.
Cool.
Exactly. And that's where the meager funding was coming from, because she was just, mm-hmm, a recognizable face. And then she dropped out. My buddy Miles and I came up here anyway, and we shot this just as a joke, as a rallying cry to say, let's forge ahead and find other people. We shot a trailer for the movie where I played all the parts. Mm-hmm. Just, you know, as a joke, because I kept saying to the kids as we were reciting lines when I was in New York, and I would be like, just say it how I'm fucking saying it. This is how we used to talk. Just say the words how I'm saying them. Don't get actory about it. Just say the goddamn. And then I would always say, it would just be so much easier if I just played all the parts. Then I wouldn't have to coach you guys who are saying stupid words. And so we made a trailer of the movie where I played all the parts, and it would like freeze frame. It was, you know, and with Franklin's Tower playing in the background, freeze frames of starring Judy Greer as played by Colin Thompson, starring Nat Faxon as played by Colin Thompson. Like, I'll send you where it all went wrong later. But, and so I edited that. It was like all in one day. It was just so silly. And we did that and sent it out. And then everybody went apeshit over it. They're like, this is the, you know, my buddy Rich Cook, who is serving as my agent, but just being a good friend, he went bananas over it. And he was like, this is so much more interesting than just making a traditional movie. All like the cast drops out and the director decides to play all the parts himself. And it's on mushrooms. You had all the excuses packaged. It's all prepackaged. Anything that they say doesn't make sense, you can just say you're on mushrooms. So, and then through that, I rejiggered some things and just agreed to do it, and it would do it for less money. But I was like, if my thing, and it's not a blessing and a curse. It's my curse and its own curse. I don't have much weight or like patience as far as getting things done, especially with a movie, because you never know when the next time you're going to be able to do something again is.
Right.
And I was like, screw it. But this story is getting told. If a year from now, I'm not going to even like these words. So if everybody's fired up to do it, let's do it. But I just said the main character, the brother, I mean, the best friend, the Briggs character stays. Because that's what this story is a, it's a ode, love letter to my long dead best friend who died back in 2001 from the early pioneer / victim of the opioid crisis. Mm. So that was, if the heart that you felt in it came from that, because it was a love letter to a dead pal. And so I rationalized playing all the parts because I didn't want to wait. And what you saw was what we gave, Joe. So that's the long and short of it. I mean, or long and medium sized of it.
Right.
That's how I put a wig on and a dress.
Right.
So, yep.
So it's a beautiful film. And like it tells kind of this classic story, right? Of these people that are a little, maybe too young, get their hands on some mushrooms. And, you know, this is kind of everybody's story almost.
Totally.
Right. And maybe some slight variations.
Yeah.
Yeah. And you go off on this adventure of sorts. And I think for a lot of folks, it was on a college campus, which, you know, has its perks and drawbacks. But, you know, in your scenario, you're kind of in this land that was familiar to you all, which is really kind of neat.
Totally.
It seemed like there was a lack of stress from environmental factors.
Like, yeah, well, absolutely. Well, I think, you mean for the characters or for...
Totally. Like for the trip itself.
Yeah. Oh, for sure. And you just, it's that terror of when you're outside, all of a sudden being inside around a bunch of people. Like, why did we come? Why did we, like, going to a party? Why the fuck did we come here?
Yeah.
You know, it's such a funny, it's just too completely different, obviously. You know, every experience is its own snowflake in itself. But like the difference between doing a fistful of mushrooms at 15, 16 years old and having that, the paranoia built into it of like, I got to go home. Like, look at my goddamn pupils. Look how we're behaving. We have to go home in an hour. What even is an hour?
Yeah.
And then shedding all those, and in your adult life, shedding all that all the noise of thinking you're going to be in trouble and being like, oh, this is it has a completely different purpose. It's a completely different, and I don't even want to say experience, it's a completely different animal, you know? I mean, you're still scared shitless, but for different reasons, not because your mom's going to catch you.
Right. And I think you did a really great job with, you know, that whole ending sequence too. Like the level of stress wasn't, you know, typically I think parents are just going to like quote unquote kill their kids.
Right.
But this is far more compassionate and beautiful.
Yeah.
With some good humor, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. I was writing it. I just knew immediately how I wanted it to end. And I just knew the song and the feeling. And that song, the Ricky Lee Jones song, Woody and Dutch on a Slow Train to Peking, it was, I'd written it in, and I was like, even before I started writing the script, I was like, that's how it's going to end with that song. And so we edited the movie, and we're trying to license songs. We had no money left. And I'm like, well, I haven't really locked up the Ricky Lee Jones song, but it's in there and it's already, and we've already like, it's final cut. And I just haven't really left myself out. And I'm like, and I, so I call, like email our manager, and one of them's really cool. Like has a place up in Vermont. So he dug me. Then he was like, you got to talk to her other more kind of agent-y manager guy. Was kind of more cutthroat. And I was like, hey man, I was like, we don't really have any money. And he was just, he was pretty short on email. He's like, send me the movie. He was like, if she likes it, she'll do it. She doesn't really care about the money. She's just a badass like that. He's like, he didn't say if she likes it, she'll do it. He was like, if she doesn't like it, there's no way you're going to be able to use it. And I was like, fuck. I was like, we might be fucked. Because what if she's like, but for whatever myriad reasons, what if she doesn't mm-hmm. like the fucking movie or my face? And, you know, so I sent it along and he wrote back, like, she watched it that night. So she loves it. Go ahead. And that was, it was in like a dark, I was in a funk with like the producers over like things and like just wondering if any of this was worth it and how is this movie going to be received at all? Is it going to go like maybe in 20 years it'll become a cult classic with the cult of 10 kids.
Right.
But her saying that, I was like, it was the most overwhelming relief, if that is an oxymoron. I hope so.
Yeah.
You know, it was a beautiful moment that I desperately needed. Her digging on it and letting us use the song kind of fit with how I envisioned that final scene to be too.
Mm. Well, that's really cool. And yeah. You know, an interesting kind of grace, right? Like, oh yeah. Thank God.
Oh yeah.
And now you can go forward.
Yeah.
Yeah. And has it been kind of, well, obviously it's been weird. So, you know, COVID shut down most screenings.
Yeah.
So yeah. How has it been? Like you haven't been able to do like a red carpet situation or anything like that, but.
No, yeah, I mean, with that, it's you try to get the festival route.
Mm-hmm.
And we got rejected from it. And it's with the festival, it's like it has to do with what programmer you get on which certain day that watches it. And so we got rejected from a couple, and then we usually have a Burlington screening. We actually did last mm-hmm. year. We have so we got it in before the pandemic, and then with the pandemic, that was all just back and forth between distributor and doing that deal. So we got a screening in for the locals, and I'm wary to say that it would have been a huge theatrical success. I'm not saying it wouldn't have been, Joe, but I don't know if mm-hmm. if you could catch it at the local AMC. I think we were right. bound for streaming regardless, but yeah. We did get a good screening in for the townspeople of Chittenden County.
Yeah. Cool. And so are you Where does it go from there? So you had to, you know, start working with, you know, some publicity people and trying to get some press about it.
Yeah.
That's probably how y'all got in touch with me.
Yeah, exactly. Well, you know, the distributor, Gravitas, seems to pick up every one of their mother's movies. So we were like, so what's the deal with publicity and whatnot? And they were like, well, I forget what the term was. It was like we have a surplus of a content surplus or something. We're like, you guys are kind of on your own. And it was like, okay, cool. So Jess, who has been in correspondence with you, is not our PR point person. Jess is my girlfriend, who's nice enough to reach out. God love her to everybody and try to get some eyeballs on this thing. So we didn't even have any. There was no budget for publicity.
Mm.
7 days, the local Burlington Rag did a piece on it, mostly because the kid who wrote it, the dude who wrote it, you can't really call it a 38-year-old person kid anymore, I guess. My buddy is a buddy of mine, and he knew us. And I went to high school with him, so he knew the story. So he like led the charge on that. But getting, we got a really, really bad review from this guy. I looked at it's a normal thing to do. I looked the kid up on Instagram. He's just like a 23-year-old college kid. Just like roasted the movie so hard. It was so, I just wanted to.
Oh my God.
So fine. I forget what he said, but he said something about like, he compared it, or he didn't. He put it alongside, he made fun of it in terms of like what Terry Gilliam. He referenced Terry Gilliam, and then he was like, ripped the animations to shreds, which are all completely supposed to be Terry Gilliam like Monty Python like cutouts. It was Don't get me started, Joe. I don't want to talk. I'm going to look him up right now. I want to call him out on the air. But in his defense, he's just a baby boy, and that's fine. It was one of the two reviews that we got. So
for the animation, like my response was like, I thought it was super interesting and unique, and I was really impressed that the production company like wanted it. I was like, this is so different that I hadn't seen stuff like that since really Monty Python. And yeah, I'm like, wow, this is fucking cool to kind of see it again.
Yeah, it added that's all Miles. He's that stop motion stuff. Give him a bubbler, an eighth, and a 12 hours, and he will cut out some crazy things.
That's awesome.
No, he's not that much of a stoner. No, he's none of this happens without him. And I loved it. And this movie more than the others were, dare I say it, kind of the me show. And even though this one is the me show times however many, like with those animations and it became more Miles and I's movie in a weird way than the other ones. And you put that in, and then the score, it all kind of moved as one kind of, there was some synchronicity to all the things that were happening in there. I think that resulted in you feeling good at the end. I think, is what we're saying.
Right. Well, so there's very little psychedelic film happening.
Yeah.
And, I don't know if you've been able to see or heard about Malibu Road.
No.
But your film and Malibu Road, which I've only seen the trailer for, and I talked to the team there for like 2 hours at one point. They're like, what has really been all that psychedelic? Like Enter the Void was okay, but it was a little maybe over the top for a psychedelic film.
Right. What's Malibu Road? I'm looking at it now.
Yeah, well,
is it worth a damn?
It's kind of like a psychedelic noir. Totally worth it. I haven't had the chance to watch it yet, but I'm like, I've been thinking about this movie for, 2 years now or however, whenever it came on my radar. And I don't think it's even available for streaming yet, but yeah, it's kind of revisiting 60s North Los Angeles, like Malibu area and all the canyons there, like Topanga. And there's another one that's like right next to it. That's like a really big deal for psychedelic history. Like a lot
Laurel
of the
Canyon.
Most influential bands. Yeah. Laurel Canyon. Yeah, so it's like Laurel Canyon meets Malibu and Topanga and just like the weird psychedelic nexus. So it's like, why is there so little psychedelic cinema? Like does psychedelia have to mature? Or like what's going on? And like why is it you that, came to the table with like a pretty good psychedelic film?
Because I originally it was I wanted to make the least, like we were saying before, the half-baked of the world. I wanted to make the least trippy movie about tripping. It's like this is before it all spun out off its axis, and I ended up playing all the parts. But I wanted the psychedelics to take, but just to be a constant like underlying fuel for the thing, but not to take lead on anything. And I think why people don't do it more, hopefully it's that it's a fear of why I would be hesitant to do it, even though I did it, if that makes any sense, is to respect the experience, not to get it right is, I'm not saying that we got it right, but we got it kind of right. And it's through whatever cosmos we filtered it through. It's a tricky one to get right. And I think hopefully people are just hesitant to do it because it's, they don't want to disparage the miracle that is the psychedelic experience, be it LSD or psilocybin.
Mm. Right. Okay. So,
or maybe producers are just like, it doesn't sell. And that's why we got,
that's kind of where I'm thinking it too. It's like this nexus between like, somebody being so convinced that they can do it and other people, you know, saying, no, you can't.
Yeah.
At least in terms of like producing dollars for the companies, right?
Totally. So I mean, like, it's, yeah, I wrote a baseball movie, and you have many people told me that my agent at the time, he was like, I wrote this script and I spent, you know, however long, a couple months writing it. It's a baseball movie, minor league baseball in the Northeast. And he was like, I just have one macro note. And I was like, well, I don't like the sound of this already. And he was like, really? No, he said a really small macro note. And he's like, can you make it about something? Can it be something else besides baseball? And I was like, well, no, it's a baseball movie. But he was just like, baseball movies don't sell. And so once they get the stigma attached to it and people, and you know, cause you know, that movie with John Hamm and you know, Trouble with the Curve did terribly. So everybody was like, well, baseball movies are done. It's like that kind of, you know, scarlet letter on the thing.
Mm. I hear what you're saying though. Like these particular topics, like people in the business get an idea that this trend is over. It's not going to perform.
Right.
The level the business wants it to, which is kind of a weird thing, right? Like this art form has to be interfaced with business intrinsically, yeah. Just based on like the dollars required, right?
Totally.
To do a certain level of art, like you can do something super duper low budget and not really need money, but it, you know, there's issues there with production and
yeah.
Actors and impact.
Oh yeah. But yeah, there's probably a slurry of reasons why people don't do it. There was that movie with Michael Cera, the magical cactus in the Winky Pond or something.
He was in a psychedelic film.
Crystal Fairy and the Magical Cactus. Yeah.
And then, wow, from 2013. That's interesting. Silva, I did not know about that.
Yeah, yeah, that's good.
That's funny. Looks like he's fresh off the playa. And there's another film that like tried recently. This couple actually ended up holing up in a cabin,
right.
A small place in Joshua Tree, and like the lady running the place was essentially like the dealer slash shaman.
Right.
Did you watch this one?
I don't know. What was it called? Was it called Joshua Tree or something?
Let me try to find it. I don't think it was called Joshua Tree, but you know, it's Joshua Tree is a pretty iconic place for people to consume psychedelics.
Oh yeah. No, absolutely. I mean,
I've not done it yet, but I'm probably not too many years out.
Yeah, no, it's beautiful. My buddy has a place out there. You know, aforementioned, Rich Cook. Find it on Airbnb for the low, low price of a lot of money a night.
Yeah.
But there are probably some mushrooms in the drawer next to the record player.
Perfect.
Yeah.
Yeah. So we're seeing the trend. Like people are trying, right? And I think like how do you do some sort of coherent story with psychedelics, which, you know, often a single narrative isn't really enough.
Right.
To like piece it together, you know?
Yeah, I mean, and that was kind of what helped me was when I wrote the movie, I went and just... I was in a rut, and so a lot of times when I get into a rut writing or generating any sort of creative fucking thought, I turn to a big, I think the buzz term is hero dose of mushrooms. And so I, you know, very cliched, I took a bunch of mushrooms and went and hiked the Ray Miller Trail in Ventura or Malibu, somewhere up there. And at sunrise, and the movie kind of, I had a nugget of what I wanted. I knew I kind of wanted Super Bad at Mushrooms, but the movie kind of, you know, laid itself out for me. And it was, because there is a lot of hysteria, obviously, in tripping your nards off. But also, it's, you know, with the waves and the troughs of a trip, it's a lot like the conflict kind of resolution that you want with every scene in a movie that you're just kind of bouncing in and out of. And anything that doesn't have that kind of conflict gets left on the editing room floor. So you always want that push and pull, and I think it's not dissimilar to going out of your mind on mushrooms, because you have those very peaceful valleys that you can go, that where everything's fine, kind of, and it's lucid, and then you have those moments of just sheer hysteria where you know nothing and everything is right there. But I think that helped in oddly enough focus exactly what I was writing about. Like, this is all you need. You need this, the nuclear family, the divorce thread as a B story. And then we just, and each scene has is given its own conflict and resolution through the waves and the troughs of the trip.
Right. Yeah. It requires a different kind of nuance.
Totally.
So the film I was talking about with Joshua Tree is called, pretty funny name, Debbie and Doug Drop Acid in the Desert. It's a little on the nose. But it featured Paul Scheer, Maria Bamford, and Larry King.
Great Larry King?
Yeah, the recently late Larry King as the voice. I don't know that they showed him, but they definitely had his voice.
Debbie and Doug. Yeah, there we go.
Debbie and Doug, and, you know, Paul Scheer and Maria Bamford alone. I was like, yeah, that's a hook. That's the clickbait that got me there. And Larry King, I was like, okay, Larry King talking about drugs. I'm probably going to want to hear it.
That's funny. Yeah.
But yeah. You know, decent enough film. I would like to talk to them.
Did they get it right? Yeah.
They did okay. Oh, so I want to watch it again.
Got it.
It wasn't a full feature, I don't think. Cool. What 25 minutes. So I should watch it again.
Yeah, you have the time.
Yeah, and free.
Yeah.
Yeah, but it's interesting, right? It's like similar to what your situation in your film was, but it's like a more romantic love relationship, and they're trying to reframe it, and LSD might help them.
Right.
Was the question asked, I guess. And it was quite the ride. I think they did the trip part pretty well. Yeah. I think it maybe didn't leave as big of an impact on me because it was only 25 minutes, right? Not a full feature, right?
Well, I don't know if it was good enough, Joe. If goddamn 5-minute movie should leave an impact on me.
It's true. 5-minute movies are where it's at. Yeah. So, yeah, like this whole, I just hope your film and these others will inspire folks to hopefully like pick it up and start doing more cool stuff.
Yeah.
Like psychedelic film and different angles. Like, nobody's done Fear and Loathing on the campaign trail. Like, that's ripe for like a spin on the Trump campaign, right? Like,
totally.
Update it from Nixon, you know?
Yeah. And what is
that? Could be incredible.
What's the drug he makes up? And then
adrenochrome.
Adrenochrome. Adrenochrome.
He mentions it.
Yeah, but no, it's not. Adrenochrome is the thing that everybody thinks of. Clintons are harvesting baby blood from and Pizzagate, isn't it?
So if you remember the scene in Fear and Loathing Las Vegas when they're talking about the pineal, the essence of pineal gland that he bought off some Satanist or something.
Right.
Like that particular scene near the end of the film. Mike Jay in his book on mescaline actually gets into the history of adrenochrome and how it was like a speculated substance, oxidized adrenaline essentially. And he speculated that there was results, but they never really did any science on it. So, and this whole idea of mescaline microdots, like there's not enough, microdots can't hold enough milligrams of material for it to be an effective dose of mescaline. So it's all like a weird speculated drug history. But was there another drug in that they kind of made up there?
Yeah, it was something, Ibogaine.
Oh, well, that's a real one, but it was barely known at that point. Like in Hunter Thompson did a good job, like surveying the science.
Right. What the hell is
drug culture? Ibogaine is the drug inside the plant Iboga, and it's used to help people rapidly detox from opiate addiction.
Oh, really?
So some people think with 1 to 2 administrations, you can cure their substance use disorder, but it's not that easy. But at the very least, they don't have to go through the dope sick phase where they're, you know, vomiting and kind of felt like they have the worst flu they've ever had, you know?
Yeah. Interesting.
Yeah. So he is a master of bringing in these fringe new things, or was a master in those things. Yeah. So, you know, that's a frontier, right? Like, you can play with a lot of those interesting new drugs in fiction.
Oh yeah.
In interesting ways. Yeah.
Yeah. But yeah, then you run into what we were talking about before, becoming too, you don't want it to become, and I haven't like done
sensationalized drug humor.
Sensationalized. Yeah. To disrespect the thing. And that's, I haven't really felt the need to really shake up the snow globe, oddly, in a while. When that feeling comes, I do it. But, I don't know why I think it has to do with what we were saying before. It's the coming off of the playa, a bunch of people from Silicon Valley going out, doing the thing that I held so dearly.
Hmm. Right. Cause you in your film kind of show how sacred it is to you.
Oh, good. 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 Good.
And you know, that's not what other films typically show us when it relates to drugs, like Fear and Loathing in Las Vegas. You know, I can kind of identify with that use pattern a little bit, but I clearly it's not like a sacred thing. It's totally. Like, this is full tilt debauchery. Maybe I'll find some sacred things here and there, but it's, you know, the intention is not, you know, the sacred or getting my life straight.
Yeah. I think that's what where this movie kind of benefited from spinning off the rails was in the original iteration where everybody's cast up and I wasn't in the goddamn movie, but you know, it's about being that age. And cause it was a fairly, you know, semi autobiographical story. And, there was a specific night where I remember it was on the downslope. We were coming down. It was on that, you know, confused kind of euphoria. And then something happened in the stars of my mind where everything was way too much. And I was at 16, or 15, I was, life was going by too fast. I was already too old. And I just had the entire world folded in on itself. And I was just like, I don't know how to stop this roller coaster. And I was just overwhelmed and I burst into tears. And I looked at my buddy, the Briggs character. I kind of came up because, you know, somebody had said, "What, like, giving me shit for bursting into tears." And I looked at my buddy, and we had this kind of this moment that you can only have on, you know, on the downslope of a mushroom trip, where he was so like respectful and almost envious that I had accessed a place of that much emotion at that age. I'll just never forget his eyes in that moment. And I don't quite know what brought us to that little anecdote, but where were we? Mm. It was Ibogaine.
So we were talking about, how.
Oh, you were saying that the respect for the experience came through.
Yeah. Like the sacredness.
Totally. Cause I think that's what it benefited from going off the rails and me playing all the parts. Cause in the original version, this is how we got there. And when we were kids, it was more of the fear and loathing thing. We were just trying to get, you know, fucked up. I don't think we were eating mushrooms and we were doing that, but we were also like, just a couple of years earlier, when we couldn't get your hands on any grass, you were like smoking some dried maple leaves and graphics bong just because you didn't know what else to do. But so I think that's where you see the older character played by a guy who looks like me kind of going through this ceremonial thing, and in rewriting it like that, I think like you said, it allowed us to convey how sacred and meaningful it is to all of us, who, myself and then the people who made the movie. Specifically the guys on the ground here, not the Reed Carolins and Channing Tatums in the world.
Right. And it's, you know, this, so being in my position, right? Like I'm trying to educate folks as much as I can about the uses of psychedelics and try to minimize like the stories that show up on the news.
Yeah.
So like, when I saw you walk into the woods with the dog, I'm like, uh-oh. Like, you know, as
as good of an idea as it is, like I get a little nervous too.
Yeah.
Where I'm like, oh shit. But you know, I know more and more people who this is their practice.
Yes. Yeah.
Right. Like not everybody flies to Brazil or Peru.
Yeah. I mean, I think that's, and you would, this is a quick question. Like I've gotten used to doing it on my own and it's, and that's how it's not the only way I can do it, but that's how I get the most work done. Mm-hmm. And if you do experience it regulated and in a clinical way, in a therapy, like how many of those people become freaked out by the people that are administering it? Like, don't you get into some murky territory there where somebody, not by no fault of theirs, but just by the alignment of whatever, is triggered, chemically triggered in the person that's taking him, is like, does the quote unquote shaman or whatever freak that person out? I know they're professionals, but that's why I rely just on freaking my own self out and eliminating all the variables that might make me spin off the planet once and for all. You know, but do you encourage that kind of measured practice in you're saying that it kind of freaked you out when I was going in the woods?
Well, so it's a hard thing, right? Because there's like my personal use, which I try my best not to get explicit about because I wouldn't want anybody else to do that. But then there's like what I'm supposed to tell folks. And it's like, you know, how do we do this as safely as possible?
Yeah.
So like the only thing I would, like if I was to make a suggestion of what I would, you know, not for your film, but like if I was going to advise somebody, like, okay, you're going to do that. Cool. So it's not my first choice for you, but you know, at the very least, just have somebody there with you.
Right.
Maybe they're like 200 feet off just watching you.
Right. That'll fuck with you,
and
Joe.
If you wanted the alone, but you know, realistically, that's not really what happens, right? Like people do what they want to do. Like I know a dude that had 20 hits of acid on his 20th birthday and he just walked out in the woods.
And never came back.
He did actually. God. One of the best massage therapists I ever met. So it's like a weird situation where like, I know you could die out there.
Yeah.
But you know, are we not risk tolerant enough? Which is a question I think came up on one of our recent Friday episodes.
Right.
I don't know what the answer is there. Like in indigenous cultures, people would get left out overnight sometimes.
Yeah.
Like, okay, we're going to bury you up to your neck and you're going to live in these New England woods.
Right.
You know, overnight we'll come get you like at noon the next day. Like I think in the Abenaki tradition, they did that and you know, it's not all the way safe, especially at the point in history when wolves still existed.
Right. Yeah. You know, she had face get stolen by a wolf.
Right. So, you know, and there's other factors too. So like, is safety, I don't know. Like I always push for safety because any sensational story that comes out works against our mission here of making these things far more available than they are today.
Yeah. Yeah. And then I think just especially if you mix in the elements also, it's like in the movie on a warm day in early June in the Northeast before this, like set yourself up for not success, but you know, set yourself up for not failure.
Yeah.
Like don't in the middle of the winter, cobble a bunch.
Yeah, totally. Like rain, cliffs,
rain. Yeah.
Like slipping and getting a big laceration.
Yeah.
You know, like in the Northeast, like it's hard to, like the woods in the US Northeast are so safe. It's kind of hard for me in Colorado now to even relate to how I felt about the woods back home.
Right.
Because now I know there's things that'll kill me out here in Colorado.
Yeah.
So
that guy who had to beat up a mountain lion, turned out it was just just a kid.
That story is insane.
Yeah. It's my worst nightmare. Like when I was walking, when I did a bunch of mushrooms, and anytime I'm like I had my headphones in, and when I was out in California, that overhanging cloud of like, what if this is the time when my skull gets peeled back by a mountain lion?
Mm-hmm.
So that's what happened. Okay, let's say that to our listeners, Joe, don't
yeah.
don't don't go around, don't hike around listening with headphones in if you're tripping. Even as much as you want to, you got to be able to hear what's going on around you.
Yeah. Yeah. Like, even just for other humans.
Yeah. Yeah. Maybe more.
The trick is just to stay away from them a little bit.
Yeah.
Yeah. And yeah, you want to be aware of what's going around or on around you. It, like, if you didn't want to know what was going on around you, the alternative is to lay in bed.
Yeah.
It's pretty easy.
That is pretty easy. Safe. To do. Yeah.
Yeah. So I'm kind of curious, like you seem to have, so there's this kind of orthodoxy in the psychedelic world, right? Like you have to use these words, you have to have this like style of persona when you're talking about psychedelics. It's kind of like a little obnoxious. And you know, you're kind of representing the tradition where this is like you're representing, I think, the majority of users in your film.
Totally.
That aren't kind of part of this core orthodoxy that, you know, MAPS and Psychedelics Today and all these other groups are kind of pushing, right?
Yeah.
And so, like, I want to respect that because this is, you know, the majority of people I knew growing up, like, totally. That's how they were doing it too.
And that's what I was saying before, like, and that's why I like your show, because you, whereas it is very serious and the stuff you're talking, you're taking the material very seriously. When just listening to you and your buddy, Jimmy New Jersey, whatever his name is. You guys don't, you take the material very seriously, but you don't take yourselves seriously, where that would be obnoxious as a listener. And that's why I think your show works so well. So thank you for that. I think, I don't know. I agree with you. There is, you can get pretty serious about these things. The scholars out there.
Right. And I think a lot of folks want to be taken seriously because it's such a amazing and nearly sacred topic for them, if not literally sacred. And how do you, how do you show it respect? You try to like bring as much professionalism as you can at times, or on the alternative, like let's go as full new age as we can, which, you know, has its place at times.
Totally. But I think with having the underlying like Baba Ram Dass kind of love and mm-hmm. respect for the whole thing. Like it can be fun as the fucking day is long, but I think as long as there's like, you know, the stakes of it or the lack of stakes, whatever lens you want to look through.
It's interesting, right?
Yeah.
It's like plus or minus and go so far in either direction or in zero direction. It's so crazy. Like that to me is one of the more interesting things around the psychedelic angle, is just how diverse the experiences are, how far in different directions people go with it.
Yeah. It was up on top of that mountain in Malibu was where that the line from the movie came to me. Cause it was my mantra of however many hours as I was walking and the sun was coming up and I was losing my fucking marbles. But in those peaceful valleys, I kept saying to myself, I was like, when it's not scary, it's fun. When it's not scary, it's fun. When it's not scary, it's fun. And, as with life, you know, and that's what the Briggs character says at the end of the movie. He looks at him, he's like, well, and I mean, I'll take a moment to say how great of a job Russell Posner did in that role that I couldn't have dreamt anybody on this earth could have done that great of a job playing my dead best friend. So that being said, but he delivers the line in the movie, when it's not scary, it's fun, which I don't usually say that I like things that I do, but I like that line. I'll say it and I won't take it back without no disclaimers, no nothing. I love that.
That came to you in an experience.
That fucking line. And that came to me, in a lull of a hysterical trip. Not always hysterical, haha, as we know, but hysterical nonetheless.
Hmm. Yeah. And that's something we should ponder. Like if someone wants a tool to meditate on relative to their past experiences, like think about that. Like I'm flashing back to a time I had too much in public. And like that makes a lot of sense. Like it was pretty fun when it wasn't scary. But you know, there there's the physical stuff where I'm just vomiting. It wasn't that scary. I'm just like, why am I puking so much?
Right. What is this?
Doesn't make any sense.
Come on. Where were you?
Music festival, of course.
Yeah. What music festival?
Oh, it was on the banks of the Colorado River, a little north of Vail.
Yeah.
Beanstalk.
Beanstalk? Yikes.
Yeah. Probably one of my favorite festivals, really small.
Who was playing?
Well, the Magic Beans, Talk, Goose. You had Calm Trues, who's a kind of famous DJ.
I try to keep my members of the Disco Biscuits. There we go. Now we're cooking.
Job. One of those. Not the full band, thank God.
Not the full Bisco experience.
Yeah, which I could usually let pass. But
did you?
Yeah, it was.
Do you like? Were you a fan of the fellas from up here in Burlington?
Yeah, yeah. Paid them way too much money. I probably bought them a house by now.
This is great news. That's funny. It was my girlfriend's kids we were listening to. I was like, what better stuff to listen to? Like, as if they're, you know, going to be 8 and 10 soon. And it's just such great music for kids. I loved them in my own way, but I've grown up so close and so many of my friends going like the tour route. I always try to keep them at arm's length, but do have a unshakable love for that band.
If I got into it at that stage, like, I would have been a very different person.
Yeah.
And I'm thankful it hit me later.
Well, that's what, maybe I should just, they should stop listening to it, because the Briggs character, my buddy Briggs, he listened to them from early. He was at like Sugarbush 94, you know, like 11.
Good Lord. Yeah. Early.
and he's dead. So maybe that's not the right. I'm just kidding. It's not, I'm not blaming them for his death, but yeah, I figured.
It's certainly a container. That's a little tough. Like, there has been a lot of psychedelic fallout.
Yeah.
Through, like, and you know, not just psychedelic fallout, like psychedelics are just part of it.
Oh, they didn't want anything to do with this movie. Because I originally, Caspian was going to be the last song as the credits rolled.
Mm-hmm. They said no.
They said no. And I was like, can we wear a couple t-shirts and like, can we pepper some stuff in? I thought they were going to be all for it because it's a Vermont movie, but they were all against it. They were like, they don't want to be associated with the thing.
I think their relationship to drugs has become really strange ever since Trey had to go to rehab and jail and house arrest and all that. Like,
totally.
It's a really interesting shift that they've had to do.
Yeah. But we ripped off Tweezer Reprise in the score, so they can
outstanding.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's it's an interesting angle, right? Like, that's a whole thing that I want to get into more, is like, how does a touring musician survive and survive well? And, you know, not be like a total, like, shut
slob,
in, you know, or slob. Yeah. Like alternatives. Yeah. Like,
yeah,
I'm going to be like the guy that washes my hands 800 times a day and doesn't talk to a fan, or am I going to go on the other end?
Yeah.
And like, really, you know, probably spend too much time partying with fans and not sleeping enough. It's like, where is that healthy lifestyle balance for a touring musician? And it's not easy to find.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Speaking of,
well, not why we're here to talk, but go ahead.
Mm-hmm. No. We started talking about music, but I wanted to mention the guys that I did the score with, because I heard you talk about Esalen a couple times on the show. And where we scored the movie was up in Big Sur. And my buddy works kind of at Esalen. He lived up on this, on this hill. We scored the movie over a couple of days. But he's in this band, now kind of defunct, but they were together at the time, called The Range of Light Wilderness. It was him, this guy Tommy McDonald, and Nick Abes, who I did the score with, but they were in this band with a friend of mine, Jesse Campbell, who played drums. And I knew her first, and then the band is, they have just one record, it's called The Range of Light Wilderness, and I can compare it to how sacred I feel like I hopefully got across in the movie that a mushroom trip is to me, that record is up there with that. Like, you can't contextualize it. It's just a perfect, timeless piece of a masterpiece. I'm going to go ahead and call it. And if Tommy McDonald hears this, I'm going to say that I'll double down and say it's a masterpiece. Because I love those guys and I love that record. And that the score of the movie, I think, is anything that you feel that is are residuals of a trip are due to the sonics of the score, I feel like. And those guys, it was amazing work that they did. This is, I don't know what you're doing to me, Joe, but I'm getting so sincere. I never typically do this, but thank you.
Oh, you're welcome.
I think it's important. Like, you know, you go on Jimmy Fallon to talk about your film eventually. Like, how authentic can you really get with Jimmy Fallon in a minute and a half of conversation, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's a length of time, right? And art deserves this.
Oh, good.
And it doesn't usually get this.
Totally.
Yeah. So we're a bit over time, but is there anything we might have missed storytelling wise?
No, I mean, I think that's why I just wanted to mention those cats that helped me with the score. I'm just trying to think of anything like, and Russell, I mentioned Russell. I said, I seem grateful. I did a good job of putting on a veneer of grateful for everybody that helped out, even though I did all the fucking work. Just kidding. You can print that. Don't make him laugh. Yeah, I didn't talk too much shit and I seemed grateful. That's all I want in this life, you know? to not talk too much shit and to just appear grateful.
Yeah. Hell yeah. Cool.
Anything else that you want to say, Joe?
Well, I advise people to watch the film. It's
Thank
great.
You. Oh yeah, it's called Light Years.
It's Light Years.
It's on the Amazons and the iTuneses and
cool.
And yeah, it's available to rent for a couple bucks. And then yeah, you get to watch the other movies.
Yeah. Yeah, I can't wait.
Good.
Don't eat as many edibles as I did. I wish I could give people an idea of the milligrams, but it was too much. Did
your girlfriend really enjoyed it? Why was she?
Oh, she's just slightly less on edibles than I was.
Slightly less on
she's
edibles.
Better. She's more composed.
Did she have a
she's
couple
got
cocktails?
Her shit together more than I do.
Right.
One more time.
Did she have a couple cocktails?
No. Well, actually, she might have had some beers. I don't remember.
It's a. I mean, it's also it's a drinking movie. It's a celebratory.
It's. Yeah, you might not be wrong. You're right there. So I don't know. Like, I want my listeners to watch it and let me know what they
cool.
think.
I appreciate you.
I want more opinions.
Encouraging them to do that.
Yeah. And what's the core website for your...
I would get like loserscrown.com has kind of all the movies, but the first thing would be Light Years is the first thing on there. Mm. It says click on the dog's head. Yeah. So it's right there. It's the loserscrown.com has a bunch of... I promised my girlfriend that I wouldn't talk any shit about myself. So I was about to say a bunch of the crap that we've done, a bunch of the the pieces that we've worked.
Masterpieces.
Yes, a bunch of my well plotted out masterpieces. A lot of thought goes into all of this. No, loserscrown.com has everything there, and then I think there's a lightyearsmovie.com that has all sorts of fun little. But bits of content. Oh, it's important, Joe. I'm glad I have you here. Because I don't know if you didn't watch this because you didn't know that I wasn't supposed to play all parts of the movie. There's this. We did this little short, kind of animated short. It's longer than it feels. On the lightyearsmovie.com page, if you scroll down a little bit, it's called "I Was Not Supposed to Be in This Movie," and there you see me, and I do an explanation on how this all came to be.
Yeah.
It's like a lengthy trailer and a disclaimer that is much like the last almost 38 years of my life.
I'll be watching it. One
lengthy disclaimer.
21 minutes, 26 second disclaimer. That's excellent.
Yeah.
So there's a lot of extras, we'll say.
Yeah. Yeah, I think that's, I feel good. How do you feel?
I feel like we covered it. And if people want to dig right in, watch that film.
Good. Thank you for saying that.
We need more psychedelic film and we need to support the psychedelic film that's here. I think it's really important and it fleshes out a story in ways that, you know,
nonfiction can't really do. So yeah, thanks for your effort, Colin. And
thank you, Joe.
Yeah, I hope people watch Light Years. Yeah.
Thanks a lot. I appreciate it. I dig the work you're doing.
And there you have it, Colin Thompson, Light Years. I hope you all check this film out. We might be doing some collaborations with Colin on this, so stay tuned. Nothing formal yet, but I really like the film. I think people should watch it. And, you know, this is a way that people get exposed to mushrooms. And, you know, everybody thinks, oh, you have to do it with a shaman. You know, not necessarily true. Or a facilitator. Not necessarily true. Sure, the risk profile is a little higher if you don't have a sober sitter, but largely pretty safe. I don't necessarily encourage youngins doing it this way, but this is what happens in the wild. So, or as the scientists say, in a naturalistic setting. Kind of a weird way to say it, but that's the term of art on that. Yeah, I guess that's it for the film. Thank you, Colin, for being here, and really glad to connect with you. And I wish you the best of luck, and I hope you make more psychedelic films. Please, please, please. Yeah. So again, if you want to support us, check out our classes over at psychedeliceducationcenter.com. We get some free ones, and we've got some courses on Carl Jung and psychedelics, psychedelics in the shadow, and our kind of flagship foundations course, Navigating Psychedelics for Clinicians and Therapists, where we go through a ton of material over the course of an 8-week class, and kind of study on your own and then come to class, and we kind of break it down together. And yeah, probably the most fun I have as part of Psychedelics today is teaching that class. We might have some new additions coming up, but you'll hear about them. If you listen to the podcast or follow us on social or get our emails, you'll definitely be hearing about everything else that's coming up. I think there might even be a ketamine class coming up, so stay tuned on that one. No promises on timeline yet, but we should have some announcements out soon. So I think that's it for now. Thank you all for tuning in. This is Joe Moore signing off for Psychedelics Day. We'll see you next time.